Okay, welcome everyone to the second session of the day. Our first speaker is Csaba Király from Hungary, and he's going to be talking to us about sparse graphs and an augmentation problem in rigidity theory. Okay, all right, go ahead, Csaba.
Thank you. Welcome, everyone. So I will talk about augmentation problem, which is related to rigidity theory. But let me first start with the well-known augmentation problem of two-edge connectivity augmentation, where our task is to find an edge set of minimum size such that it makes an input graph G two-edge connected. This problem was solved by Ezvaran and Tarjan, and just let me recall their solution for connected graphs. So in this case, we need first to shrink the two-edge connected components of the graph. It results in a tree. And next, we make this tree two-edge connected by connecting its leaves. So our solution for our problem will be quite similar to this. So our problem from rigidity theory is the following. So we say that the framework is rigid if it has no continuous deformation. So which type of framework do we think of? For example, it can be a bar joint framework which consists of stuff bars which are connected at flexible joints. And it's known that this framework here is rigid, but if we delete this edge here, then we can start to move this vertex around this bottom vertex here. And also, if we delete this diagonal edge, then we have a more complex flex. We can speak also about body bar frameworks, which consists of rigid bodies, which are connected by stuff bars at flexible joint points. And in all cases, we may think about rigidity framework can be represented by a multigraph. And it's known that usually the rigidity of this framework depends only on the graph itself when the joints are in generic position. And what two-edge connectivity means in rigidity theory? It means redundant rigidity. That is, if we delete an edge of this graph G, then the framework remains rigid. So the problem of two-edge connectivity augmentation may be asked in this sense. So we may ask to find an edge set of minimum size to make a rigid graph redundantly rigid. So for example, here, we have seen that if we delete this red edge, then the framework is not rigid. So we may add this blue edge here. But we can observe that the framework is still not rigid because if we delete this bottom red edge, then it still has a flex. So we need to add one more edge, and one can check that this resulting graph is redundantly rigid. So as we want to give a combinatorial algorithm for this problem, we need to formalize the problem more combinatorially. So given for this, we use, sorry, because I am at the university and they are making some announcement. Okay, so for characterizing rigidity, we usually use sparsity. So we say that the graph G is chaos sparse if each vertex set X, which induces at least one edge, induces at most K times the cardinality of X minus L edges. And KL spells graph is called KL tight if it's maximal in this sense. So this type of graphs may be familiar for you in some special cases. For example, in the K equals L equals one case, a one bar sparse graph is a forest and the one bar tight graph is a tree. And by Nash-Williams result, KK tight graph is the union of K edge disjoint spanning trees. And they used this type of graphs to characterize minimal body bar rigidity in RD for the case where K is D plus one choose two. And 2-3 tight graph were used by Polacek, Geiringer and Laman to characterize minimal body bar joint rigidity in the plane. And there are other applications of sparse graphs in rigidity theory. And based on these applications, we say that a graph is KL rigid if it has a KL tight spanning subgraph. So for example, in the 2-3 case, we say that it's 2-3 rigid if it's rigid in the plane. Okay, so now we define redundancy for this KL sparse graphs. We say that an edge is KL redundant if we can delete it, and after deleting it, the rigidity of the graph is maintained. And we say that the graph is KL redundant if each of its edges is KL redundant. So our previous problem from rigidity theory is the following. We are given a KL rigid graph, and we want to find a minimal edge set such that if we add it to G, then the result is KL redundant. And we will also consider the reduced version of this problem when the input is KL tight. So in the 1-1 case, it's a 3. So there are some special cases of this problem which were considered before. The K equals L equals 1 case is just the 2-edge connectivity augmentation problem. The K equals L case is the K3 connectivity augmentation problem, which was solved by Frank and Tamás Király. And the 2-3 case is the rigidity augmentation problem in the plane. For this, Garcia and Teher showed that the reduced problem is solvable, but the general problem is NP-hard. Okay, and let me see our results. So we will give a min-max theorem for the reduced problem, and we also provide an n-square time algorithm for it. And we will show that the general problem is always NP-hard when k is less than L. And in all other cases, we will have an n-square time algorithm by reducing it to the reduced problem, similar to the 1-1 case. Okay, so for our min-max theorem, we need some facts from rigidity theory and on sparse graphs. It's known that the edge sets of KL sparse subgraphs form the family of independent sets of a matroid on the edge set E. And this is the graphic matroid for the 1-1 case and the two-dimensional rigidity matroid for the 2-3 case, which may be familiar for you. Based on this matroid, we know that if we have a KL tight graph, which is a basis of this matroid, then if we add an edge, then this edge induces a minimum K, it induces a circuit in this matroid, which will consist of this edge ij and the minimum KL tight subgraph tij of G inducing both I and j. And we will use the notation of R even ER to denote the edge set that get redundant after we add these edges E1, ER to G. So it's easy to observe then that when we add only one edge, then only exactly the edges in TE will get redundant. And it's also easy to see that if we add multiple edges, then that set of these tight subgraphs get redundant. And our first lemma says that only these edges get redundant after this addition. Okay, and our Mimax theorem will be based on cotight sets, so we need to define them. So now we are given a KL-tight graph. We say that a set X is KL-tight if it induces a KL-tight subgraph of G. And we say that a non-empty proper subset of V is KL-cotight if its complement is KL-tight. Okay? So now we can observe that if we have a cotight set and I and J are not in X, then the vertex set of Tij is disjoint from X because V minus X is a cotight, is a tight set containing both I and J, and Tij is the minimal tight subgraph containing both I and J. Okay, and this observation implies that the set of the end vertices of the edges used in our augmentation must intersect all KL cotight set. Because otherwise that is which are which have an endpoint in that cotight set won't get redundant. And hence, if we have a family of disjoint cotight sets, then we need at least half of its cardinality for the augmentation. Moreover, we can show that in fact equality holds. So exactly this number of edges are needed for the augmentation. For example, in our initial example, we had this graph. We have shown that two edges are enough to make it redundant. And we can see that these three sets are cotight because if we delete any of it, then the resulting graph is a tight graph because it's rigid in the plane. 2-3 tight. Okay, so I've lied a bit because our Minmax result holds only if we have at least one KL cotight set. Because if we have no KL cotight set, then we can add any edge and the result will be KL redundant. And this latter part is easy to see because if there is no KL cotight set, then VTUV must be equal to V. Because otherwise V minus VTUV will be a cotight set, but there exists no cotight set, so it must be the empty set. Okay, and our previous lemma implied the max is less than or equal to the min part, and now we need to show the other direction. And this is obvious when the minimum is one because we have at least one KL cotight set, so the maximum is also at least one. So we can assume that the minimum is more than one. In this case, let us consider the family of minimal KL cotight sets. And our main lemma says that the members of this sister are pairwise disjoint, in this case when the minimum is more than one. But its proof is quite technical, so I skip it here. But now we know that C star is in this maximum, and we will show that, in fact, the maximum is taken over C star. So next, we show that any connected graph on a transversal of C star augments G to a KL redundant graph. To this, we first showed that there are no edges between any two members of C star, so they are not only disjoint, but there are no edges of G between them. And we proved that if we take a vertex of a member of C star I and the vertex J, which is not connected to C, so it's not in C, neither in its neighbor set, then Tij will contain both C and its neighbor set NC. And so now we know that we can add a star of cardinality C star minus one, which augments G to K R redundant. And now we need to reduce the number of edges in it to obtain C star over two. And we use the following lemma. If we have Y X1, X2, and X3 from distinct members of C star, then the union of these three sets, Ty X1, Ty X2, and Ty X3, will be equal to the union of these two blue or these two red sets. That is, we can always change two edges out of these three to one edge, and still the same edges will be get redundant when we add them to G. And this implies that the cardinality of C star over two edges are always enough for the augmentation. That is, the maximum is at least the minimum when the minimum is more than one. Okay, so now let us turn to the algorithm. In our algorithm, we will always assume that KLL are constants, and this implies that KL tight graph on n vertices has a linear number of edges and the vertex number, because it has KM minus L edges. And it's known that one can check KL tightness of a graph in n square time based on an orientation algorithm. And after one checks this, the KL tightness of G, he can calculate Tij for each ij in V in linear time. And based on this algorithm, we were able to construct a minimal KL cotight set in quadratic time. And we will use this subroutine for our algorithm for the reduced problem. So first we need to check whether one edge augments G to K R redundant. For this, we need to calculate Tij for each pair I and J. Next, we search for a minimal cotight set X, and we take a vertex from X and Y from X, and we calculate the tight sets TYV for all other vertex V, and we take the maximal ones out of these tight sets, tight subgraphs. And finally, we use the last step of the proof of the minimax theorem, this reduction step, to reduce the number of edges repeatedly. So it's easy to see that the naive running time of this algorithm is cubic. However, with some work, we were able to reduce it to quadratic. Okay, so now let me turn for the general problem. To solve the general problem, we need a generalization of the reduced problem. So we need to generalize sparsity as follows. We are given now a modular function on the vertex with the positive integer values. And we say that G is ML sparse if the previous condition, in the previous condition, we change k times the cardinality of f x to the sum of the values of m on x. And similarly, we can define ML tightness. And I just say now that all our previous results expand for ML tight input graphs. So how can we use this fact?
You have 5 minutes.
Okay. Okay. So how can we use this to solve the general problem? So it's known that the KR redundant edges of a KR rigid graph for K at least L form vertex disjoint induced subgraphs. And if you shrink this vertex disjoint induced subgraphs one by one, then the result will be an ML prime tied graph for some M and L prime, which can be calculated based on K and L. And now it's enough to augment this ML prime tied graph to ML prime timed, ML prime redundant, and this can be solved by our previous results. So this way we can solve the general problem when K is at least L. And as I told you at the beginning, when K is less than L, then the general problem is NP-hard. Our NP-hardness proof is based on the set cover problem, which implies also that it's NP-hard to give a constant approximation for this problem. And finally, I just show you an application in rigidity theory of these results. So we can also consider bar joint frameworks on surfaces. So now our framework lies in the three space, but the joints are restricted to lie on the cylinder. And Nixon, Owen, and Power characterize the rigidity on the cylinder as follows. So this framework will be generically rigid if and only if the graph G is two tight and simple. So now simplicity makes sense because so two three case we also needed simplicity, but it was obvious because of the 2-3 sparsity condition. But now in this case we may have parallel edges, but we need now simpleness for the characterization. And this means that we cannot use parallel edges for our augmentation, but in cubic time, we will able to solve this problem when the input is simple and we want to find a simple augmentation. So when we use at least two edges, then our algorithm always outputs such an output, because we have seen that the members of C star of which was the family of minimal cotite sets are not connected in G, so and we added edges between the members of C star. And otherwise we can show, so when only one edge can augment G to KR redundant, that if the complete graph on V is KR redundant, then we will always find an edge which is not in G, which augments G to KR redundant. And similarly, we can solve the augmentation problem for KR rigid graphs, simple KR rigid graphs, then K is at least L. Okay, so let me summarize our results. So we give a minimum theorem for the reuse problem and a quadratic time algorithm. For simple graph, we gave a cubic time algorithm, and we shown that the general problem is NP-hard when K is less than L, and it's solvable in quadratic time when K is at least L. So thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Csaba. I'm going to ask everybody to unmute themselves and give a round of applause to Csaba, please. Thank you. Right. Are there any questions for Csaba? I have a question. So I find it very interesting that you have a min-max theorem there, yet you're not able to solve the minimization problem in polynomial time when K is less than L. It's the first time I see such a phenomenon personally. For the minimization problem, is it clear what the graph looks like if the minimum is the maximum possible, which is the number of vertices divided by 2? Is there a nice characterization?
Let I go back to the min max theorem. So here is the min max theorem. Okay. Mm-hmm. So what was the question? Sorry, because.
An upper bound on the minimum would be the number of vertices divided by 2, right? Based on your min-max theorem.
So it's the number of disjoint chiralkotite sets divided by 2.
Yeah, which is at most the number of vertices divided by 2, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm asking, is there a nice characterization of when you get exactly number of vertices divided by 2?
So I think the one maybe for KK tight graphs we may have. No, for K zero, for L equals zero, it may happen that all vertex itself is a chiralkotite set. So in that case, it may happen that it's V over 2.
I see. Okay.
So you can think about the cotite set in such a way also that the edges which have at least one point in that set, the number of these edges is equal to the k times the cardinality of x, because you get this from the sparsity condition, and for a singular set it means that its degree equals to k.
I see.
And when the degree of each vertex equals to k, then it must be a k zero tight graph.
I see. Okay. All right. Well, thank you. I see a question's been raised by an audience member. So for k less than L, is there any good approximation algorithm? I mean, and they continue. I mean, approximation ratio is sublinear, not.
So you can use the approximation of the set cover problem. So with log n approximation, you can get. So because it's something like a set cover problem. So you can calculate Tijs, and now you just need to cover the head set by this Tijs. So it's exactly the set cover problem. So you can get a log n approximation always.
Okay. All right. I think that addresses the question. Yeah, it has. Okay. Are there any other questions? All right. If not, let's move on to the next speaker. Thank you, Csaba.
Okay. Bye.